INFJs have an incredible ability to focus on such big, long-term important ideas that they often forget the practical, everyday things that might even get them labeled as stupid.
Stupid. Stupid little girls. Stupid dreams you never learn.
But that's not all, because in this video, we're going to cover the 6 stupidest things all INFJs do and usually don't realize until it's too late. If you know anyone that could benefit from this, feel free to share it. Now, let's get down to the list. Number 1. They are so focused on big dreams that they forget about everyday details. We mentioned earlier how INFJs focus on big, important ideas, but often struggle with everyday stuff, a trait which might make them feel dumb. If you're an INFJ yourself, have you ever wondered why you struggle with details of everyday life? Why is routine, practical stuff such a challenge for you? While at the same time, you have no trouble contemplating even the biggest of ideas and philosophical questions. We live in a practical, detail-oriented world, a world made for sensors, who make up 70% of the population. They focus on what they can see, hear, touch, smell. You get the point. They take information at face value. Unlike sensors, NFs, or in this case, INFJs, prefer to relate and care for people. While sensors focus on real, actual specifics, INFJs speak in metaphors.
That's correct, Wendy. We all wear masks, metaphorically speaking.
They fill out their conversations with meanings they've inferred and possibilities of what could be. To put it simply, their language is far more imaginative. Their primary function, introverted intuition, or NI, prefers theory and the abstract. This is a great thing, which is why INFJs tend to be great innovators, visionaries, writers, creators, and thinkers. This is also why they have trouble with the repetitive and concrete aspects of day-to-day life. In other words, INFJs don't fare well in situations that require them to be in the moment. They would rather look to the future and focus on their big dreams. Number 2. Overcommitting. INFJs are known to be incredibly loyal and reliable. If an INFJ believes their work will contribute to the greater good, they will dedicate 100% of themselves to that cause, which is absolutely great for the people around them and the company they work for, and not so great for INFJs themselves. Because in giving 100% of themselves to a certain cause, they will completely abandon their own dreams. Heck, they'll even put their whole life on hold just for the sake of the greater good. Not a very good strategy, I'm sure you would agree. They'll stop at nothing just to make sure others are well satisfied, and this often comes at their own expense. No matter if they're focusing on friends, colleagues, or a company, they all come before INFJs themselves. To make matters even worse, other people, or companies, especially companies, aren't exactly known for their appreciation of that kind of commitment, or, as is always the case with INFJs, overcommitment. But INFJs just never learn. They keep overcommitting themselves, completely abandoning their own dreams for aspirations in the process. And they'll continue to do that until it's too late.
Nah, I'm afraid it's too late for that.
Until they're forced by circumstances, losing their job, for example. And that's when they realize that they wasted months, even years, serving someone who doesn't appreciate it. But again, it might be too late. What INFJs should realize is that other people often have their own agenda, and unlike them, working towards the greater good is just not a priority. Number 3. Idealizing people. We're all just humans. Most of us are, anyway. Which means that we're not perfect. INFJs tend to forget this, and when they find that special someone, their feelings are, well, let's just say deep and intense. And that's putting it mildly. And that's where they start idealizing them. Don't get me wrong, idealizing our partners is normal, to a certain degree. We've all been guilty of that at some point in our lives. I sure as heck know what it's like. But the way INFJs idealize people is different. It's pretty unrealistic and also unsustainable in the long run.
It's not rewarding, it's unsustainable.
What INFJs do is they magnify their partner's virtues and overlook their flaws, which practically means they're settling themselves up for a huge disappointment in the future. Heck, INFJs even tend to praise their partners for qualities they don't even possess. Most people don't like that, unless they're narcissists, of course, but that's a topic for another video. Back to INFJs. They make a big mistake thinking that all praise must be flattering to the other person. Spoiler alert, it's not. Being praised for something that just isn't true is not flattering. It's awkward and uncomfortable. What's worse is that INFJs don't just idealize their romantic partners. No, they do it all the time, with their friends, teachers, colleagues, even bosses. And they don't even try to hide it. Quite the opposite, actually. They make it painfully obvious.
Once you know, it's actually very obvious.
And that right there makes other people feel pressured and uncomfortable. Number 4, chronic dissatisfaction. INFJs are introspective and philosophically inclined. This sounds great, but there's a downside to them being this way. And that downside is a little something called chronic dissatisfaction with life. It makes perfect sense, because if you're questioning things all the time, if you're asking yourself how things could be better all of the time, then don't be surprised if you are constantly dissatisfied. And INFJs know this feeling, or rather a state, all too well. They're always yearning for something better. And you want to know the worst part? They don't even know what something better is. And you don't need a degree in psychology to know how incredibly painful that is for INFJs. We're talking about an enormous amount of pain here.
I just saw someone who's going to bring me a lot of pain someday.
But it's not only INFJs themselves that are in pain because of it. This also affects people around them, especially their partners, friends, and family members. They just can't understand why INFJs have this weird tendency to manufacture some crisis every once in a while. INFJs are just so busy focusing on the what-ifs that they don't realize how their constant dissatisfaction affects people around them. If you're an INFJ and want to stop feeling constantly dissatisfied, you should learn how to just accept that things are just good enough sometimes. There's nothing wrong in trying to improve, but INFJs take this to a whole new level, to the point of burnout, and yes, constant dissatisfaction. Number 5, they can be people pleasers. INFJs are all about creating harmonious relationships with others. They just crave harmony. In fact, they crave harmony so much that they avoid conflict, even when necessary, like a plague. Because if there's one thing INFJs hate, it's letting someone down. So to avoid that uncomfortable feeling, they have this urge to help others. They're just obsessed with helping others, to the point that they even have a hard time saying no. So yeah, they're pretty much unable to set strong boundaries. Heck, they have trouble setting boundaries at all, let alone strong ones. And don't get us started on what being in the midst of conflict means for INFJs. It's an absolute hell for them.
We're going to get married, be broke. We may even starve. Absolute hell.
They're trying to avoid conflict so much that they would rather let their voice not be heard than confront someone. INFJs are known for being more compliant, which is why other people often take advantage of them. They are also quite emotional, and other people often accuse them of overreacting and exaggerating. No matter if people think they're overacting or not, the feelings are very much true to them, and their suffering is real.
Our suffering is special.
And when they avoid conflict, that just results in even more suffering and emotional turmoil. INFJs would much rather withdraw, even disappear altogether, than communicate their needs, which would be a healthy way of dealing with things. Because the thing is, when INFJs are avoiding conflict, they're actually compromising their actual feelings. The next thing they know, frustration is building up, which can be really bad for their health. Number 6, self-blame. No matter what happens, no matter whose fault it is, INFJs will always find a way to blame themselves. You can be sure of it. and that's especially true when it comes to relationships. It's a good thing to take accountability for your actions, but this is not what we're talking about here. This is something entirely different. INFJs just take this whole accountability thing to a whole different level, where they literally blame themselves for everything. More often than not, this is an undeserved blame, which could be classified as a form of self-abuse that requires therapy. Whenever things go south, INFJs start aggressively thinking about their role in that failure to the point of becoming obsessed with it. They're literally driving themselves insane by thinking about what they should or shouldn't have done or said. What's even worse is that they do this when they have no control over the events whatsoever. If you're an INFJ, please do yourself a favor and don't pick yourself apart and blame yourself for everything. Chances are, it's not even your fault. If you want to know about some creepy things that all INFJs do, make sure to check out the video we did on the topic. Also, hit that subscribe button for more value-packed content like this every single week.